Needless to say, last night's high-performance person, who I molded myself, is not like any of the others. You heard about NEOM, which is the city of the future, which is a big 25 or something thousand square kilometers of sand and dog shit, basically, out in the middle of nowhere. What are some of the takeaways about listening to Kleinfeld?
Very methodical and process driven.
Well, all the guys you've heard are process driven. It's just that he talks about it more. What else about him?
Perfect son-in-law.
Hmm?
Perfect son-in-law.
Perfect son-in-law. I don't know. Well, I don't know his wife. I know his wife well, but I don't know his wife's mom. So that's probably pretty accurate. What else?
He shows extreme interest in the metrics and shares those metrics and holds people accountable against objective metrics that everybody can look at instead of some subjective.
Management by objectives is where lower to middle management agree on some metrics, and then it goes up to the senior management, and they agree on the metrics, and they massage it, and then it goes up to the board level, and they accept it or they change it. But then the board or the CEO hold everybody in the food chain to those metrics because, in theory, you all agree to them. And it's called management by objectives. And and it goes back to what gets measured gets accomplished. And the theory is if the lower middle manager agreed to 11%, whatever, and then the next level of management says, yeah, no, it should be about 11.5%. And then there's no way, in theory, for the various layers of management to say, well, fuck, that's too high, that's too low, I never agreed to it, et cetera, et cetera. And it's been around, that kind of management style, for shit. Not forever, but it's certainly for 60, 70, 80 years. But it still doesn't work because my experience is that these guys down here are going to put objectives that to make the guys above them happy and not necessarily achievable. When it works is when the guys down here make them real live numbers that are achievable. But what is achievable down here in middle management, for example, when they're making cars and the cars are going through the belt, and they should get 1.6 cars per hour, 1.6 cars per 10 minutes, and it's the guys that are putting the bolts and all the other things together, and that's really too high. We can only do 1.2 cars. But Tesla, Elon Musk says we're going to go 5,000 cars. And so then they just divide it up going down. Well, how many cars do they have to put through an hour? Well, it's 3.6 cars. And the guys on the assembly line said, fuck, there's no way we can do this. But they don't necessarily re-listen to the guys on the assembly line. Because unfortunately, especially public companies, are managed quarter by quarter because of the announcements they're going to make to the shareholders. And you've read about and seen not just Tesla, but a lot of big companies fall with the publicity, they either negative publicity or the lack of positive publicity they get based on reporting earnings, etc. But he is process driven, no question about that. What else about Costco? Yes, sir.
You can tell somebody how to sail a boat, or you can sit them around a fire and tell them stories and make them want to sail.
The management by story and around. And I learned that from Costa Gratzos, because that's how he managed. Of course, he had a plethora of stories dating back for 60, 65 years with he and Mr. Onassis. And that's why there's so many stories in this seminar. There's more stories now, 25 years later, than when I first started giving the seminar, because the seminar stories in the beginning were mine based on the high-performance people that I used to be with. And then over the years, there's more stories about you guys, and or horror stories, depending on when you want to look at it. And now, of course, with the webinars, those are nothing but stories. They're stories that you either can resonate with or not resonate with. But Klaus is he's a great storyteller. What else about it? Yeah.
He communicates through all levels of the organization and is open for feedback, for communication through all the...
That's more modern day. 20 years ago, I won't say that senior management didn't give a shit what the guys down the road or swept the floor said, but there's more of them now. So the good news that's come out of political correctness, if there's any good news, is that the people at the bottom have a voice. The problem is, just as I told you, you know, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Just because you've never met anybody like me doesn't mean there's not a lot of guys and gals that are like me. And so when you're trying to listen to the feedback from the people at the bottom, they're giving feedback vis-a-vis the five people that they hang around with. And those five people that they hang, chill with, aren't necessarily the people that you want driving your boat towards the goal line, or driving your boat towards earnings or a certain ROI, rate of return, etc. And so that's where, on one hand, it's good because they get to, you know, they get to have a say-so. The bad news is their say-so quite often isn't worth a shit, because they're not relating to the investors that are buying into the company, or the investors that are buying into the shares want a return on their investment. They don't care if you need two afternoons a week to take your kid to the soccer game. They don't give a shit that, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, that's in a utopian world. Well, to the best of my knowledge, utopia doesn't exist yet. It might, you know, 1,000 years from now, but it doesn't now. And a lot of the millennial objectives or goals or desires are very utopian in a perfect world. And we all are old enough in this room, even the youngest, to know that the world's not goddamn perfect. And so when they drive those agendas, they're normally in direct conflict with senior management. And even though senior managers now get on CNN and they get on all the talk shows and they say how they're interested in what their shareholders think, you know, the truth of the matter is, I mean, without shareholder value, I mean, and I understand that, and everybody understands that, but there's different ways to get shareholders value. And what else about Klaus? Yes, sir.
The story of him in the bathroom with the workers there and their response to him, the way he interacted, was kind of powerful to me.
Yeah, and that story is probably true. Because Klaus does believe in the little fella. Klaus believes that the world can still be saved. I don't. So they couldn't have picked a better guy to run Neon than him. I mean, even though he just got thrown out on his ass from before, I mean, he landed on both feet. And but he really believes. He believes that, and I'm positive part of it is because he comes from Germany and the war and all those things. And so he, I'm going to say he has German guilt, because he's got no reason to have German guilt, but he certainly believes that the world can be a better place. But the kids, and he's not, well, he's a kid to me, but the kids today know that the world can be a better place, but they underestimate dramatically the time and effort it takes to make the world a better place. Like the chart from the first day, the planet's been around since the Big Bang about a little less than 14 billion years. We've been here as we kind of look like Homo sapiens now for 200,000 generations. So it's taken us 200,000 generations to fuck us up. So it's going to I don't know if it's going to take us 200,000 generations to unfuck us, but it's carrying placards around the embassies or rioting like they're doing in various parts of the world now isn't going to turn shit around. Was another question?
Oh, just towards the other end, the letters that he asks for every week resonates with me. We write letters every month to the Admiral. And if you write them with, like, fluff in it, you're going to hear about it via personal phone call. So it's a very strong parallel.
Well, he follows the exact same weekly reporting system you're going to get. The exact same. In fact, his is shorter. And that weekly reporting system is the weekly reporting system that I got from NATO 50 years ago. And it used to be one page. What did you do this week? What are you going to do next week? Problems. Now they call them challenges, but they were called problems. And the only difference is it's really detailed, those three sections. And then there's a fourth section now that I added about a year, year and a half ago. At the suggestion of one of you guys, actually, it was a great idea. What am I not telling Dan? And that's where Pandora's box gets opened up. Because with all the questions and all the details, and no matter how I spin the questions, there's still shit that's not covered. Otherwise, there'd be 5,000 questions. And what am I not telling Dan? I hear all kinds of stuff. Mostly ugly. Hardly ever good. But you feel like you're cleansing your soul, you know. If Dan really knew what I was up against, so you put it in that section. What am I not telling Dan? And one of the guys said, this is about a year, year and a half ago, I had trouble focusing this week. And then he goes on to say his brother had attacked his mother with a knife, stabbed his other brother who was trying to protect his mother. He ran off and the police chased him. They caught him. The mother didn't want to press charges, so he got released from jail. He attacked his mother again with a scissors this time. And he goes on and on and on and on. And I'm surprised he had time to do anything in the week. And I went down and I tried to bail my brother out. I bailed my brother out the first time out of jail, but the second time I wouldn't bail him out. And he goes, oh, and I go, fuck. And that's what he wasn't telling Dad. And he was putting that in there. Well, maybe you're looking at my report results, Mr. Peña, and I didn't get that much accomplished, but this is why. This is why. And So that's right. So we have four sections. We have the fourth section. Anything else about Klaus? Yeah.
Klaus dispels the myth that you have to be an alpha type leader.
Absolutely. That's for sure. He's the antithesis of alpha. Yeah. Although he's been around about a lot of alpha leaders, because I know some of the guys that he's been around, notwithstanding myself. I still remember, I can close my eyes, and I still remember meeting him the first time, 1997, October of 97. We're sitting down, we had an hour, and he comes out, and this is before, you know, laptops and that kind of thing. And he has these 6 or 7 pages of notes, and the first 2 or 3 items were, you know, he took a class in building rapport and all this bullshit. And after 3 or 4 minutes, I says, well, you got 56 minutes left, Dr. Kleinfeld. So let's dispense with all the horse shit because I'm getting up in 56 minutes, not 55 and a half minutes. So he skipped 5 pages, got down to the meat of what he wanted to talk to me about. And so we worked very closely for 10 years straight. But his goal was he wanted to be on the corporate executive board of Siemens. And there were 11 divisions then. And each division, one of the directors ran a division. And I said that I'd work with you if your goal was to be CEO of the corporate executive board, which he ran the whole deal. And then 2002, January, I think it was, he was appointed CEO. It's interesting that Rick Scott took 7 years to build. Klaus took about 7 years to get to be CEO, and QLA works in the corporate environment, albeit slower, because you've got to deal with a lot of other personalities. At QLA, you're mainly dealing with your personality. In the corporate world, you're dealing with a lot of other people. He is a terrific student. He actually follows instructions, and he's pretty good at holding himself accountable, which, and his habits were pretty extraordinary. Anything else? Any comments about Neom? If you were a Saudi or you spoke Arabic and you have anything to do with engineering and infrastructure, you buy a one-way ticket and you never come back. Never. You leave your kids, you leave your family, you leave everybody, and you never come back. There are going to be at least a million billionaires made out of that project. At least, minimum, a million billionaires. I've got a couple guys there. PhD, went to school there 16 years, speaks Arabic. He's brushing up on his Arabic. And because there's just, everywhere you look, there's opportunity. Because when you, it's basically just, it's not just as it's a blank piece of paper, it's just 25,000 square meters, kilometers of dirt, sand, that shit's going to be built on. And as the, that's probably the first place you're going to have flying cars and all that kind of stuff like you see in the space movies. It's quite a project. And there's already been about $2.5 or $2.6 trillion added onto the $500 billion. So it's already a $3 trillion project, but I'm not going to be calling myself the $3 trillion man anytime soon. Anything else about Klaus or the differentiation between his management style and, anybody else or Neom?
He's doing all his emails himself, but touching paperwork and emails.
I do all my, people always see, right? You probably won't see this, Mr. Peña. I see every email. I mean, I don't respond to hardly any. Because and the emails that they send to the websites and stuff like that, Kat and other people see, and then they know how to filter what I'm probably interested in seeing. But most of the big guys don't see, but not even a fraction of all the correspondence they get. And Klaus does. I don't know if I had anything to do with that, but. He is very responsive, and he does care, but he also cares what people think about him. He also cares less than you, but he still cares. So he still has that chink in his armor. That's his Achilles heel. Anything else? Now, when we're not on camera, we're going to do goals, affirmations. So if you have your goals and affirmations on your written homework, don't pass it in, and we'll pass it in later. Okay? Anything else? Okay, YouTube.